to understand this. Just because you're a vegan doesn't mean you have a healthy diet. You know, you can eat potato chips. You can eat a lot of, you know, a lot of fried stuff, a lot of, you know, you can eat a lot of junk. You can be a junk food vegan, and that's not good either. You know, I suspect if you're going to be a junk food person, it's better to be a junk food vegan than be a junk food omnivore. But, you know, neither is a very good diet. But, boy, you're really lucky that your mom got you into this when, you know, you were, what, 11? Because it will pay nothing but great benefits for you as you get older. You know, you'll see it. I mean, how many kids your age are walking around now with artery problems, with, you know, I mean, there are children 8 years old that have, you know, that have blocked arteries and have all sorts of circulatory problems because they're all the junk that they're eating. I mean, that's crazy. That's totally crazy. And so it's really great that you started this young. It's really great you started this young.
Well, I do eat junk food like chips and candy, but other than that, I do eat healthy. I always read the labels, the ingredients lists, all that stuff. I do research on certain things that I might not know if they're good or bad. And
let me tell you, somebody just, you know, people always send me, you know, they send me books all the time because they want me to promote them on my sites and whatnot and when I write things. But somebody just sent me this really interesting thing called, I think it's called, it's pronounced Veganismo, Veganissimo, Veganismo A to Z, a comprehensive guide to identifying and avoiding ingredients of animal origin in everyday products. And it's written by two people, Ruben Proctor and Lars Thompson, Thomsen. And I actually love it. It's great. It's got like, it's just a guide that's got like everything you can possibly imagine, so that when, you know, when you're buying some over the counter pharmaceutical thing and you see it's got magnesium stearate in it, you know, that can be of animal origin, it can be of plant origin, but you ought to be aware of that. And if you're going to take that, you ought to call, and you want to be, you know, really conscientious about it, you should call the company and say, where's your magnesium stearate come from? Because first of all, A, you should know, but B, the more people they have making those calls and showing that consumer awareness, the more likely they're going to say, you know, what difference does it make? It costs us so little to switch to a vegetable source. If people care, if it's going to have a market impact, let's change. So, you know, yeah, so it's good to be a label reader and watch that junk food. It's not, you know, I mean, obviously in moderation, it's not going to kill you, but, you know, it's got a lot of, you know, they call it junk food for a reason, Kevin. It's junk.
Yeah. If it's not too much to ask, could you promote my show on your page as well?
Well, sure I can. Yeah, I mean, look, let me tell you, when I first got the invitation, I mean, this is the first time I think that I have been on the show of a person your age. And when I was first approached about this, I really didn't know what to make of it because I wasn't sure what sort of conversation we would have, and I see now that we're having a really very good one. But yeah, look, the bottom line is, we need to get your generation, kiddo. That's the reality. And if we don't get them, we lose. If we do get them, we win. And so, I mean, you know, yeah, it's great to be working on people my age. But, you know, by the time people are my age, you know, they're sort of fossilized in how they think about things. I'm not saying you can't change when you get into middle age, but most people don't. As a matter of fact, most people, you know, they get more conservative, they get more sort of set in their ways and stuff like that. So it is possible to become more progressive as you get older. It's not likely. So, you know, we've got to be getting the young people, and by young people, I mean the people, you know, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. We've got to get those people in two ways, Kevin. First of all, we got to get them to be thinking about veganism. And secondly, we got to get them away from this idea that what animal advocacy means is getting bigger cages for chickens or, you know, getting crate-free pork or any of that sort of stuff. We got to get them away from that idea that the solution to the problem of animal exploitation is to make it better, because that's really a bad idea. And, you know, and we can see this. You and I can see this because we live in an area where, you know, I don't know, you know, I mean, there are all these Whole Foods all over the place, and you walk into Whole Foods, and what do you see? You know, you got animal welfare, all of this, you know, this happy beef and happy chicken and happy milk and stuff, and you got a lot of these animal groups supporting that stuff. Now, I'm not saying that they're, you know, that they're bad people because they do. I just think that they're wrong. You're going to that conference at the end of June, right? The animal rights conference
Can't wait to meet you there.
Well, it's going to be an interesting conference because that I'm giving a talk there about why animal welfare reform is a really bad idea and why people should not be promoting it and why these large organizations really should stay away from those campaigns. It will be an interesting educational experience for you to be there because you will see how angry people get with me for saying that. And how upset they get because they say, well, you know, we've got to help the animals who are suffering today. And the answer is the welfare reform campaigns that they're promoting aren't helping any animals who are alive today because most of these campaigns get phased in over a period of 10 or 15 years. But the most important thing for people to understand is those campaigns not only don't do a heck of a lot in terms of making things better for animals, but what they do is they make it more appealing, or they make the public more comfortable about continuing to consume animals. And that's a bad, bad, bad thing. Because, you know, when somebody says, well, I'm concerned about animals. I really am concerned about animals. They walk into Whole Foods and they see, oh, well, I can buy happy beef and I can buy happy chicken and happy pork. And they see that the large animal groups are actually promoting this sort of thing. Then they say, hey, look, I can discharge my obligations to animals by eating happy meat and buying organic milk and eating happy eggs that are, you know, that are from hens in enriched cages and stuff. And the answer is no, you can't. You know, no, you can't. You know, it's always better to inflict less suffering than more suffering. But that doesn't make inflicting less suffering okay or morally okay. I mean, it's like saying, you know, if I'm going to murder you, I shouldn't torture you first. But we're not going to give me an award for murdering you without torturing you. And what really troubles me is you have these large animal groups that are actually sort of praising, you know, places like Whole Foods or places like McDonald's or Burger King or whatnot because they've agreed to buy, you know, 3% of their eggs from enriched, some percentage of eggs, from hens in enriched cages and stuff. And I think that's crazy. I mean, I think that that's beyond crazy. So when at the end of this month, when we meet each other at that conference, I am giving a talk. I think it's on the Saturday, whatever date that is, the 28th or 29th. I'm giving the plenary talk in the morning, and it will be interesting. It will be a good educational experience for you because you will watch people get very upset with me for saying what I just said, which I think is pretty reasonable and pretty uncontroversial. But you will see people get very, very upset about it.
I was actually watching your video this morning with my mom. I'm vegan, Gary Francione.
Yeah.
And you were talking about animal welfare and saying how it doesn't matter whether or not the animals are treated good. If you're going to kill them, the well treatment doesn't weigh in.
Yeah, First of all, you're right. You're right. And that's the video that I did an interview for that video project called I'm Vegan, I do make that point, but it's important that you understand what I'm saying there. First of all, I'm saying that as a practical matter, Kevin, the animal welfare reform isn't going to result in animals that are being treated well. That's a big misconception. When I hear people say, oh, well, so-and-so, you know, some corporation has agreed to stop buying pork from pigs who are raised in gestation crates. Gestation crates are when the sow is pregnant, she has her babies, and the gestation crate keeps her immobile. Because in a normal situation, she would be able to tell the piglets, "Hey, look, enough now. I don't want you. I don't want you feeding right now. Give me some peace. Get away from me." But in a farrow, in a gestation crate, she can't move, so the piglets get to feed constantly from her. And it's really a very, very unpleasant situation. Now, there are some people who say, hey, look, you know, if you know, X restaurant chain has agreed to buy some percentage of pork from vendors who do not use the gestation crate, the life of a pig with or without a gestation crate is hideous, number one. So you take away the gestation crate, and it's still hideous. So it's sort of like saying, well, you know, I'm going to waterboard you, but I'm going to put padding on the waterboard. Well, it's still pretty unpleasant to be waterboarded, whether there's a pad on the waterboard or whether there isn't a pad on the waterboard. It's still torture. So I think we have to be careful when we say, hey, look, you know, these welfare measures are resulting in well-treated animals. That's not true. They're still being tortured. That's point number one. Point number two is, in that video, if I remember the one that, if I remember what I said, you know, it's a problem. But I think the point I was making is, it doesn't matter, even as a matter of theory, even if we did treat an animal well, would it be all right to kill that animal simply because we like the taste of eating them? And my view is, look, I don't really care how well you treat the animal. You know, you could treat the animal beautifully. You know, you could raise the animal like a member of your family. You know, the animal sits in the house with you, you know, watches TV and blah, blah, blah. And then you kill the animal painlessly and you eat the animal. I think that that's wrong. But that's not what is, just as, by the way, if I snuck into your bedroom tonight and I put a bullet into your head and I did it the right way, you wouldn't feel anything. Would it be wrong for me to do? Yes. Of course it would be wrong.
I hate to cut you off, but we're running out of time.
Okay.
And I'm going to have my mom do some announcements. And thank you very much for being on the show. And I can't wait to meet you at the conference.
Okay, great. Thanks for having me on. And my final message to everybody, go vegan. Go vegan, go vegan. It's easy. It's easy. It's better for your health. It's better for the planet. And most importantly, it's the morally right thing to do. So thanks for having me on.
Thank you.
Take care.
Thank you.
And
so much.
Now for some announcements from my mom.
Hi. Okay, this is Susan. Hi. That was great. Oh my God, I was so happy. That's wonderful. What a great guy. I love him. I can't wait for that conference. Okay, the only announcements that I'm going to go through is, okay, we have the Animal Rights National Conference in Washington, D.C., and their website is arconference.org. And real quick, I'll say we are going to make it to the Richmond Veg Fest on the 15th. And let's see, the website for the Kevin Storm Show on Facebook is facebook.com/TheKevinStormShow. We also have the Kevin Storm Show on YouTube, which I'm working on really hard. I need some help with that.
And thank you for working on
it. You're welcome, dear. And also, we're going to be having lunch with some friends from the Vegetarian Society of South Jersey and New Jersey Vegan Families today with Kevin Storm at 4:30 at the Silver Diner in Cherry Hill. They have, I believe it's 25 new items on their menu that are vegan friendly, and we're going to be going there as a group.
Isn't one of them a milkshake as well?
Oh, yes,
isn't
they have vegan ice cream for milkshakes. And we will be there early just to greet people as they come in, but we'll officially start at 4:30 to 6:30, something like that. And we've got quite a few people coming, so if you are, you can RSVP on the Facebook page for the announcement, or you can just call the restaurant and let them know that you're coming. Silver Diner, it's on Route 38 in Cherry Hill, and that's all we have. Do you have a song to exit with?
Yes, I do. And this is Kevin Storm.